हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डू द फिफ्थ चैप्टर ऑफ आवर बुक हॉर्नबिल, द एलिंग प्लैनेट, द ग्रीन मूवमेंट्स रूम, रिटन बाय नैनी पलखीवाला। सो दिस चैप्टर इज बेसिकली टेल्स अबाउट द एलिंग प्लैनेट। एलिंग मीन्स व्हेन समबडी इज सिक और अनवेल, वी से एलिंग। सो विच प्लैनेट इज एलिंग राइट नाउ? आवर मदर अर्थ। आवर अर्थ इज एलिंग प्लैनेट। इन दिस चैप्टर द राइटर्स टेल्स अबाउट द डिक्लाइनिंग health of our planet earth. Naini Palkhiwala published this article, this chapter, in the Indian Express on 24th November 1994, and she has raised the issue about the declining health of our planet earth. So let us start now. One cannot recall any moment in the world history which has gripped the imagination of the entire human race so completely and so rapidly as the green movement, which started nearly 25 years ago. So the writer says nobody can remember any movement which was there in our history which has controlled the imagination of entire human race so completely, everybody, all human beings, so completely. It has controlled the imagination of the all human being so rapidly as the green movement has done. Means before that there was not any movement which was like this green movement, and it started nearly 25 years ago. In 1972, the world's first nationwide green party was founded in New Zealand. So it started in 1972 from New Zealand. First nationwide green party was organized or founded there. Since then, the movement has not looked back. Has not looked back means did not stop. Okay, it continued. We have shifted one horse aerobically from the mechanistic view to a holistic and ecological view of the world. So, writer says, we have shifted this now people earlier, they were just looking at the mechanistic view of the earth. Mechanistic view means mechanism, how it is made and all. But now they have shifted to a holistic and ecological view of the world, means the complete view of the earth. This movement has changed the view, people's perception and all. They were first, it was mechanistic, now it has become a holistic and ecological view of the world. It is a shift in human perception as revolutionary as that introduced by Copernicus, who taught mankind in the 16th century the earth and the other planets revolve around the earth. So the writer says it has shifted the human's perception. Revolutionary means there was a revolution, change, okay, sudden change, a big change. How this writer is comparing the big change, how it was, it's the same change like when the Copernicus, he was a Polish scientist, when he told people that in 16th century he told people that earth and the other planets revolve around the sun. He was the first person who told that other planets revolve around the sun. So this was also the same thing. This movement also was something new and changed the perception of the people. For the first time in human history, there is a growing worldwide consciousness that the earth itself is a living organism. And it was the first time when people understood, they got to know that earth is also a living organism. Those who have studied bio, you must have got the idea what is living organism. Okay, so earth was also taken like a living organism. An enormous being of which we are part. A huge thing, okay, and we are only a part of it. It has its own metabolic needs, the vital processes which need to be respected and preserved. It also have its metabolic needs. Metabolic needs mean like we know our metabolic system and all in our body. When we eat food and that changes into energy, something like that. So earth also needs that. It also goes through a process. Okay. It also has its own metabolic needs. It also takes something and gives out something. It also needs these all the things. And we should respect and preserve that. So it was told by the people when the green movement started that the earth is a living organism. And it also has its metabolic needs, which should be preserved and respected. The Earth's vital signs reveal a patient in declining health. We have begun to realize our ethical obligation to be good steward to the planet and responsible trustee of the legacy to future generation. Now, the writer says that the Earth's vital signs reveal a patient in declining health. So, what is the sign? Right now, whatever signs we get, whatever signals we get from the Earth, it looks like this patient in declining health. The Earth is like a patient whose health is declining, not well. The Earth is not well. We have begun to realize our ethical obligation to be good stewards. Now, we have realized, we have understood that our ethical obligation means our moral obligation, our moral duty. What is our moral duty? Our moral duty is to be good steward. Steward means to be good, a good caretaker. So we have to be a good caretaker of our mother planet, our earth, and we have to take care of our planet well. Stewards of the planet and responsible trustee of the legacy to the future generation. We are responsible trustee. How we are responsible trustee? When we will take care of our mother planet, earth, and we will take care of our planet, then only we will leave a legacy to future generation. Otherwise, what will happen? We already know so many species, so many things, animals or so many things, they are extinct now, which was seen by the last generation or the old generation, and we can't see them. And so if we will not take care of our planet Earth, so many things will be there which will be destroyed and the future generation will not be able to see it. So as a responsible trustee, as a responsible citizen, we have to take care of these all the things. The concept of sustainable development was popularized in 1987 by the World Commission on Environment and Development. Sustainable development means which supplies or supports the progress. So it was given, which supplies and supports the progress, the concept of the supply and support and the progress of our planet. It was popularized in 1987 by the World Commission on Environment and Development. So they gave, this commission gave the concept of support and supplies and progress of the earth. In its report, it defined that idea as development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generation to meet their needs. So what idea it gives? It gives the idea of development that meets the need of the present without compromising the ability of future generation to meet their needs. So it says that we fulfill our need through Mother Earth, we fulfill our need through this planet, but we should not compromise the ability of future generation to meet their needs, because we have to, whatever we take from Earth, whatever we take from planet, whatever we use it, whatever we need it, we have to keep it in mind that our future generation also needs it. There should be no compromise with it, because we are busy in destroying in our planet. We don't think about that eventually who will suffer. We will suffer and our future generation will suffer. So we have to keep that in mind. That is, without stripping the natural world of resources future generation would need. So what we have to do, we have to, without stripping means destroying. So we, without destroying the natural world, all the resources that future generation would need. So we have to keep this in mind. Whatever we take, whatever we use, we use in a limit so that our future generation also can see it. In the zoo at Lusaka, Zambia, there is a cage where the notice reads the world's most dangerous animal. Inside the cage, there is no animal but a mirror where you see yourself. Thanks to the efforts to a number of agencies in different countries, a new awareness has now dawned upon the most dangerous animal in the world. So in Lusaka, in Zambia is a country where in that place there is a zoo. And it's written there the world's most dangerous animal. And when we go inside the zoo, there is no animal, there is a mirror. And we can see ourselves. It means who is the world's dangerous animal? It's human being. Thanks to the efforts of the number of agencies in different countries, a new awareness has now dawned upon the most dangerous animal in the world. he has realized the wisdom of shifting from a system based on domination to one based on partnership. So the writer says, thanks to the efforts of so many agencies, which has brought a new awareness, has now dawned on me, came upon the most dangerous animal in the world. Who is the most dangerous animal of the world? Human being. He has realized the wisdom of shifting from a system based on dominance to one based on partnership. Now the people are realizing, human is realizing that shifting from a system based on domination to domination. Now we think that we have all the power to dominate the earth, we can do anything. But now people are changing. And they are shifting to a based on partnership. It's like a partnership. When we will take care of our earth, earth will also take care of us. We have done in the last stanza that writers tells about the people are shifting to the wisdom that we don't hold this land or we don't hold this earth. We are not the owner of this. We don't have any domination on this, but we are partners. How much other living beings need this earth, how much it is there, that much of us also. And whatever we give to this earth, we get it back. Scientists have catalogued about 1.4 million living species with which mankind share the earth. Scientists have classified, they have told about 1.4 other living species. And we are there, we share with them. So we are there, human beings are there, and other than that, there are 1.4 million other species on the earth. Estimates vary widely as regards the still uncatalogued living species. Biologists reckon that about 3 to 100 million other living species still languish unnamed in ignominious darkness. So the wide estimate is that biologists, the scientists, they tell about, there are so many uncatalogued living species whom they have not classified them, and they are about 3 to 100 million other species which are not classified by scientists and still languish unnamed in ignominious darkness. A languish means something which when it gets reduced. So they reduce and they are unnamed. Nobody knows them. Nobody has cataloged them. Nobody has written their name. And they are in ignominious darkness. Ignominious means something which is defamed, means which is not famous. So they are lost in that infamous darkness. One of the early international commission which dealt inter alia with the question of ecology and environment was the Brandt Commission. So another one among these all the things, there was one more commission, its name was Brandt Commission, which had a distinguished Indian as one of its members. A well-known Indian scientist also was the member of this commission, whose name was Mr. L.K. Jha. The first Brandt report raised the question, are we to leave our successor a scorched planet of advancing desert? So what the question which was raised by this commission was, the question which was raised was, are we to leave our successor a scorched planet of advancing desert? Scorched means burnt, destroyed. So he asked the question that, are we going to leave this scorched and burn and this destroyed planet for our future generation? Impoverished landscapes and ailing environment. Impoverished means made poor, which is made poor. We have made it so poor, the landscapes and the planet is ailing. Okay, so are we going to leave our planet in this condition for our future generation? Mr. Lester R. Brown, in his thoughtful book, The Global Economic Prospect, points out that the Earth's principal biological systems are four. So, Mr. Lester R., in his book, he tells about four main biological systems of the Earth. They are fisheries, forest, grassland, and croplands. So, Mr. Lester R. Brown, he tells about four biological systems, important systems. They are fisheries, forest, grassland, and cropland. And they form the foundation of the global economic system. And these four important principles, biological system, they form the foundation of global economic system, because these are the things we use. In addition to supplying our food, these four systems provide virtually all the raw materials for industry except minerals and petroleum-derived synthetics. So, the writer says that these four systems, they provide all food materials, all raw materials to industry except petroleum, which is derived from the synthetic means chemical compounds. So except petroleum, it provides everything. In large areas of the world, human claims on these systems are reaching an unsustainable level. So the people in the large area, the people say that these systems are reaching to an unsustainable level. Unsustainable level means which cannot be supported now, because they are reducing a point where their productivity is being impaired. That is being harmed. Their productivity is being harmed because they are used again and again and again in large number. When this happens, fisheries collapse, forests disappear, grasslands are converted into barren wastelands. So when we use something again and again in the large number, what happens? Fisheries collapse, because most of the people, they are fishing, and in coastal areas and many even in every part of the world, people eat fish, and the number is very large, and sometimes they are collapsed because of the pollution, water pollution also. And forests disappear, because for how poor forests disappear, people are cutting tree and they are making their homes, factories, and different grasslands are converted into barren wasteland, and croplands deteriorate because again growing crops again and again, that also destroy. In a protein conscious and protein hungry world, our fishing is common every day. Protein hungry world means people, those who take non-veg, they eat. Non-veg is the main source of protein. So protein hungry world means people eat these fishes, and it's common every day. In poor countries, local forests are being decimated in order to procure firewood or for cooking. And in the poor, some of the countries, those poor countries, the forests are also being decimated. Decimated means destroyed, because they get firewood for their cooking. In some places, firewood has become so expensive that what goes under the pot now costs more than what was inside it. And even in some places, firewood has become so expensive, so costly, that what goes under the pot now costs more than what goes inside it. It means, what does it mean? It means what goes under the pot. Under the pot, we put firewood, okay? Cost more than what goes inside it. Inside it means food. We cook food with firewood. So in some of the countries, firewood has become most costly than the food. Since the tropical forest is, in the words of Dr. Mayers, the powerhouse of evolution. So forest is actually the powerhouse of evolution, main source of growth. The forest is the main source of growth. Several species of life face extinction as a result of its destruction. Because so many species live in forest, so many animals live in forest, different type of things we get from the forest, medicine, leaves, so many things we get from forest. So if we destroy the forest, it can be the reason of extinction of so many species. And in the result, there is a huge destruction for everything. It has been well said that forests precede mankind, desert follow. And it is said that forests precede mankind means first forest comes, then it is followed by mankind, and desert follow mankind. The world's ancient patrimony of tropical forest is now eroding. The world's ancient patrimony means heredity. Hereditarily, these tropical forests are now eroding. Eroding means reducing at the rate of 40 to 50 million acres a year. So forests are reducing at the rate of 40 to 50 million acres a year. And the growing use of dung for burning deprives the soil of an important natural fertilizer. And now people, what you must have seen when you must have gone to village, and when you can see the cows and all, people use cow dung as a fuel. They make the chapatis type of that cow dung, and they use it for the fuel. And that also deprives, what it deprives? The soil of an important natural fertilizer. So because of that, the soil doesn't get natural important fertilizer, because cow dung is said to be a very important fertilizer for soil. The World Bank estimates that a five-fold increase in the rate of forest planting is needed to cope with the expected fuel wood demand in the year 2000. So the World Bank has given the estimation that we have to do a five-fold increase in the rate of forest. Means how much we are cutting? Five times more we have to plant the tree, so that we could fulfill the demand of people in year 20. James Spitt, the president of the World Resources Institute, said the other day, "We were saying that we are losing the forest at an acre a second, but it is much closer to an acre and a half to a second." So he told that we are losing our forest at an acre a second, but it is closer to an acre or a half to a second. After 48A of Article 48A of the Constitution of India provides that the state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. So it is written in the Constitution also. The state should try to protect and improve the environment and to make it safe, and we have to preserve the forest and wildlife. But what causes endless anguish is the fact that laws are never respected nor enforced in India. But the problem is, main problem is, laws are never respected in our India, our country especially, and they are not enforced also. Like for example, the Constitution says that casteism, untouchability and bounded labor shall be abolished. It is written in the Constitution that there should not be any casteism, untouchability and bounded labor in our country. It should be abolished, it should be stopped. But they flourish shamelessly even after 40 years of the operation of the Constitution. But still it is following. So what happens in our country? Rules are made, but people don't follow it. So same thing, the protection of environment and wildlife and forest also, rules are made, but people don't follow them. A recent report of our Parliament's Estimates Committee has highlighted the near catastrophic depletion of India's forest over the last 4 decades. Catastrophic means, you know, huge, means a destruction, which is the reduction in destruction. Depletion of forest is very much in our country. And India, according to reliable data, is losing its forest at the rate of 3.7 million acres a year. So India is losing the forest, 3.7 million acres. How it is losing? People are cutting trees. Sometimes it is for fuel. Sometimes they need the land for making the house, or they need to make any factory or that. So it is being very, trees are being cut very rapidly. And the rate is 3.7 million acres. A 3-year study using satellite and aerial photography conducted by the United Nations warns that the environment has deteriorated so badly that it is a critical in many of the 88 countries investigated. So survey is done by United Nations, and it tells that it's in the environment is in a critical situation, and in many countries it is there, almost 88 countries which they have investigated. There can be no doubt that the growth of world population is one of the strongest factors distorting the future of human society. So as we have discussed in the last video, the main thing is the population growth of the country or population growth of whole world, which is affecting environment. It took mankind more than 1 million years to reach the first billion. That was the world population around year 980. By the year 90, a second billion was added. In the first one, it took mankind more than 1 million years to reach the first billion. Okay. Then in next one, in 90s, it was a second billion was added. And the 20th century added another 3.7 billion. The present world population estimated at 5.7 billion. Every 4 days, the world population increases by 1 million. So, this is the data given for the population growth of the world, and which is very dangerous for our environment and for our planet. Fertility falls as income rise. Education spreads and health improves. So, writer says fertility falls as income rise. And education spread and health improves. When income rises, then education is spread and the health also improves. Thus, development is the best contraceptive. But development itself may not be possible if the present increase in number continues. So, he said that development is the best contraceptive. Contraceptive means the means and ways we use for birth control. But he says the development itself is not possible if the population will keep on increasing like today. The rich get richer and the poor beget children, which condemns them to remain poor. So he said if this happens in our society, rich becomes rich and poor, they produce children and those who remain poor. More children does not mean more workers. Merely more people without work. So the writer says, if we have more children, it does not mean more workers are there. There will be more people, those who will be without work. It is not suggested that human beings be treated like cattle and compulsorily sterilized. So he says, it is not suggested that we should treat human beings like cattle, but definitely when population will increase in this way, which is increasing now in our society, they will be treated like cattle because they will not have any work to do. And they will be unfit for the society. But there is no alternative to voluntary family planning without introducing an element of coercion. The choice is really between control of population and perpetuation of poverty. So the choice is in the people's hand. What they have to do, they have to have a family planning. And it is between the population, either they control the population, otherwise perpetuation of poverty means continuation of poverty. Either the population should be checked now, it should be stopped, and it should be regularized, and otherwise if it will not be checked, it will not be less, then there will be continuous poverty all around. The population of India is estimated to be 920 million today, more than the entire population of Africa and South America to put together. So we can understand what is our population growth and how much population we have. It is, when we add the population of Africa and South America, we have more than that. No one familiar with the condition in the India would doubt that the hope of the people would die in their hungry hutments unless population control is given topmost priority. So this is the time, this is the need of the hour, that we have to give priority to population control. Otherwise, people will die hungry in their huts. For the first time in human history, we see a transcending concern, the survival not just of the people but of the planet. So now it is first time in the history when this green movement came, the people started thinking about the transcending concern, means going beyond the small concern and issue, thinking something above than that. The survival not just of the people but of the planet. Not only thinking about the people but also thinking about the survival of planet. We have begun to take a holistic view of the very basis of our existence. The environmental problem does not necessarily signal our demise. It is our passport for the future. So whatever environment condition are there, it's not necessarily that it will be the signal of demise, but it is our passport for the future. What we are taking to our future, I mean, how will be the future. The emerging new world vision has assured in the era of responsibility. Now it is assured means lead. So it is leading us to era of responsibility. We have to take responsibility, every individual, every human being living in this earth, he has to take responsibility of the environment. It is a holistic view, an ecological view, seeing the world as an integrated whole rather than dissociated collection of parts. So now we have to see this whole world as integrated one. We cannot take it isolated or in the parts, we have to take it as a whole. When we'll take it as a whole, then only we'll be able to take care of this. Industry has a most crucial role to play in this new era of responsibility. What a transformation would be effected if more business share the view of chairman of DuPont, Mr. Edgar C. Woolard, who 5 years ago declared himself to be the company's chief environmental officer. He said, our continued existence as a leading manufacturer requires that we excel in environmental performance. So the chairman DuPont, Mr. Edgar, he said, our continued existence as a leading manufacturer requires, what it requires? It requires that we excel in environmental performance. We have to be excellent in environmental performance. All the statements made by Margaret Thatcher during the years of her prime ministership. So when Margaret Thatcher, she was the prime minister, none has passed so decisively into the current coin of English uses as her felicitous words. What were her felicitous words? Appropriate word, correct word. No generation has a free hold on this earth. All we have is a life tenancy. So she said, no generation have a free hold. Free hold means we are not the holder. We are not the owner of this earth. But we are just tenants. We are here for life span, time span, and after that we go. With a full repairing lease. We have taken this in the lease. We have lease. Lease is given for some time. It's not given for unlimited time. It is given for few years. In the word of Mr. Lesser Brown, we have not inherited this earth from our forefather. We have borrowed it from our children. So he said, we have not inherited this earth from our forefather. Not inherited this earth, but we have borrowed it from our children. We have borrowed it from our children, so we have to keep it for them also as safe as it is now. Whatever we resources we use, we have to keep in mind that that we leave it for our future generation, for our children also. Whenever whatever that we use, whatever we resources we take, we have to keep in mind that we use it in that way, so that our coming generation also needs it. Our needs we have to fulfill, but we should not compromise with the needs of our future generation. So hope you must have understood the chapter. If you have any problem in doubt, please ask.